India Fashion Summit 2018. Here we start our second session. The second session is on hand-woven curtains with natural dyes, the Kunbi Sari, and I request fashion designer Mr. Wendell Rodericks to the stage for his address. And this session will be moderated by the editorial director, L'Officiel India, Ms. Nina Haridas. Welcoming both of you onto the stage.
Good day, everyone. I am very honored and happy to be here today to address this audience, especially for the young minds of Cochin in Kerala. Before I start this, I'd like to go back listening to what Anil and the others were talking about. Do you know when I first came to India in 1988, after I studied in Paris, I looked around and found out what fashion was available. And there was only two kinds of fashions that was available. One was this epicentered in Rajasthan, very Maharaja look, which still continues today for bridal wear. The other was this Bollywood bling, hippie kitsch, brightly colored look. And there was a third look that was not yet translated. It was an aesthetic that foreigners liked. It was an aesthetic that Indian liked, but it was very abstract. It was not tangible in a visual aesthetic. And I decided that I was going to run after that. It was an aesthetic that was based on Gandhi's khadi, based on cotton, the calm of South Indian temples, the concept of yoga, Ayurveda, and the entire South, which was not represented as the color white, which was used for mourning. And after 2 years of being chased around by then Glitterati, which now doesn't exist, and Tina Tailani at Ensemble, I finally decided that I was going to go for cotton. And I continue that at the base of my philosophy till today, to use humble cotton. It shocked everyone, and everybody said, what is this cotton doing on high fashion racks when high fashion was meant to be silk with embroidery, and normally gold embroidery. And it took a lot of fighting, but my reason for being here today is to tell all those young designers and all those young minds out there to please fight for it, because in the end, that's what's going to give you happiness, not the bloggers, though they do make us happy, and not the positive reviews that we get. But we are going to look at one cotton garment that I reinvented called the Kunbi tribe. It was very difficult to do, but I'm going to lead you through the story. So this is a temple in the middle of Goa, somewhere which you would never go to. It's a temple that was built by one of the Kadamba queens, and there they have what is called a Kunbi dance festival every year. At this Kunbi dance festival, all the tribes collect and they start to dance, and then the best one gets a prize, the best one for their color combination, etc. And this is then doing the dance. This is the first time I saw them. Mario Miranda, my good friend, in the year 2000 told me, Wendell, why don't you research one garment called the Panbaju? That led to 10 years of research on my first book called Moda Goa, but I was always fascinated by this tribe. The reason I was fascinated by this tribe was that the Kasari had long disappeared. In the hierarchy of the Brahmin caste system, they pushed this tribe to the lowest rung, and nobody wanted to wear their saris because they were afraid to be pushed to that lowest grade. And the Kunbi tribe themselves stopped weaving the saris for almost 100 years because the Portuguese, with the Inquisition and the fact that they wanted us to wear Western clothes and not Indian clothes, pushed the sari almost out of existence. And I was ashamed and I said, I am going to bring the sari back. But how to bring it back? I couldn't bring it back in the normal colors that were there, which was basically white, red, and black, made by a simple recipe of iron filings and palm toddy laid out in the sun. So these were the Kunbi details that I had. I went and observed the women. Some of them had converted to Christianity, like this group, which is dancing in front of Mario Miranda's house. Over the years, they changed their style of dress. The ones that were mourning began to wear purple, like the lady on the extreme left, and the others, the young bride would wear orange, but it was always these checks. So the first thing we did was we said, we're going to get rid of these checks. And we're going to get rid of that small dobby that was at the end of the sari to make it minimal. Now, they also wore a lot of jewelry, unlike other tribals from the rest of India. The ones that were Catholic made these beautiful chains that they wore around their necks. They wore small things that helped them in their tribal work, which was basically a set of three implements to saw through their own flesh to take out a thorn. They had a pincer to take out the thorn, and then they had a ear cleaner. They all have Konkani names. I won't bore you with them. And they wore glass beads. The important thing about the garment was, till the Emperor Chandragupta Maurya married Helen from the Seleucid Empire, we never wore our saris long in India. We always wore them short so that we could work with them in the field, get into a boat, etc. This Kunbi sari was also worn in its short version. So I said that we were going to make it in the 46-inch version that was going to be a long sari like the Indian sari which we wear today. This is the three implements in this lady's hand. These are the two saris that they would wear. The purplish color was for widows, and the other was for the sari that was normally worn in black, red, and white. They also wore these sandals made out of a crocodile skin tree, which is used to store water, still used till today. And this is how the sari is draped. As you can see, we didn't wear a choli, we didn't wear a petticoat. All that came much, much later with the puritanical British in India and the Portuguese that came to us in 1510. But the sari had a small knot on top called a daintily. So we decided that if we were going to redo the sari and give it a revival, we were first going to get our own cotton. And we got our own cotton by weaving it very light. Because I'm a minimalist designer, we wanted it to be extremely light and free-flowing. Then we said, what dyes do we use? We could not use the dyes that they were using 100 years ago. So we adopted a small tribal village that was on the border of Goa, Maharashtra, and Karnataka. They were cutting down the forest, and in that forest, the animals ran away. They got eye problems, they got breathing problems like asthma, and we told them, stop. Y'all are cutting the forest for firewood. We will give you free gas. We gave them a table, we gave them gas, and we told them, now you are going to plant the trees that we give you. We made them plant indigo, we made them plant manjista, which is a pink dye, which you'll see later. It is a dye from the time of the Mahabharata, which is antiseptic, and they tore off strips to put on the wounds of the heroes of the Mahabharata. And we made them grow various plants that they didn't, we would need to dye our saris. It took 7 years, but every year when they grew these the plants, we made them strip the plants like they're doing here, 1/3 of either the leaves or the bark, the flowers, whatever we needed, and we gave them the free gas. And they would collect these leaves and flowers, etc., bring them to us. They would lay them out to dry, and then in containers, we would start to dye them, and that's how we started to dye the first Kunbi, Wendell Roderick's revival Kunbi sari. When we started to weave the sari, there were only two weavers that were alive in Goa. One was an old man who was so old that he slept near his loom. He died near his loom eventually when we started the project. But this gentleman with the glasses on your left-hand side, called Dada, was the only one that was alive. And he basically did very small, what we call loincloths or joda potas for the gods. This kind of a cloth with a thin gold border, or this kind of joda pota, which was worn by two gods, which was worn as a loincloth. So now we are going to show you what we did with the tribals. Those tribals eventually, after 5 years, please wait, after 5 years, they began to get the forest back again. The animals came back, the women had their livelihood. We had something which we didn't bargain for. Or, since the women were on the floor cooking, the children and their husbands would talk down at them. Suddenly we had this social upheaval where they were on the same eye level as them, and they began to revolt, and the women got their women power that they so badly needed. We didn't bargain for that, but that happened. But we got our dyes. And with our dyes, we began to make this collection 7 years later, which we call the Kunbi tribe collection. We're going to show you a little bit of how the collection started. Go ahead.
Goa is a land known for its natural beauty. The sun rises peacefully over softly rolling hillsides, nudging the rivers Mondovi and Zuari to awake. The birdsong and animal calls chorus the dawn. The famed beaches of Goa are a tourist paradise. Far away from this world on the Konkan coastline, the first tribes of Goa settled in the distant Sahyadri Ghats. The three main tribal groups, the Gauds, the Kunbi, and the Dhangars, live far away from the tourist destinations. They are nature worshippers. Some converted to Christianity, others to Hinduism. Away from the terraced rice fields and swaying coconut palms, in the charming villages of Goa, the tribes live a nomadic life among their cattle and the millet fields. The only ethnic sari of Goan origin is worn by the Kunbi tribe. Dancing at Goan promotional events and the carnival, tribeswomen wear the typical red and white check sari woven originally on the handloom. Today, the weaving is reserved for the loincloth and the jora ponchas of the primal gods. The Kunbi sari now enjoys a new avatar. Designer Wendell Rodericks worked with the tribals to create dyes harvested from guava leaves, pomegranate, mangista, and indigo. A seven-year project has resulted in scarves and fabric for the Wendell Rodericks Eco Goa Room. Across the meandering Shapura River in Kolwali is the home and studio of Wendell Rodericks. In 2009, he began to redesign the Kunbi sari, shunned by society and the tribes themselves due to the caste issue. Wendell Rodericks set about reviving the sari weave, and today, with the help of the Department of Tourism of the Government of Goa, Wendell Rodericks proudly brings to Will's Lifestyle India Fashion Week the Kunbi Tribe Collection. Employing a young NIFT graduate, Poonam Pandit, Rodericks began weaving in remote villages, working closely with old weavers to incorporate Goan aesthetics into the weave, retaining the lines, checks, and ikka of the Kunbi sari. The weave is woven with pride today, thus enjoying the designer's patronage. The sari has been presented to the President of India via Goa Governor Sidhu and to aficionados of cotton saris, such as Sonia and Priyanka Gandhi, who wear their saris as a badge of Indian cultural identity. The Kunbi sari weave has inspired a range of striped cotton fabric fashioned into modern garments with innovative silhouettes and contemporary styling. In the studio at Kolwali, cotton blends with silk in meticulous sewing lines and impeccable finish. Crushed cotton and crinkled fabric create asymmetric styles with tribal emotion. The Kunbi Dentley knot is liberally used in the collection. The hand stitches create subtle embroidery lines with a keen eye for detail. The Kunbi Tribe Collection comes from Goa, not just as a sari revival, but a testament to the Goan people's lesser known weaving heritage. The Goan Kunbi sari by Wendell Rodericks has given Goa a sari lost to modern evolution. It also gives to India a unique Goan contribution to stand alongside the great cotton saris of India. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Wendell Rodericks Kunbi Tribe Collection.
Do you know when we did the dyeing, I did not realize that indigo is such a foul smelling cauldron, because first of all, the shocking thing is that the liquid is not blue, as you can imagine. It begins to oxidize. It's actually green, and it really stinks because you have to mix cow dung with the mixture, and as you dip it in more and hold it up to the air, it becomes a deeper and deeper blue. So when the neighbors, we have a small farm attached to the dyeing unit, and we grow rice and vegetables there in the off season for the rice. The other neighbors, when they saw this foul looking liquid coming out from the cauldrons. They said, please keep all this liquid for y'all because we don't need it. And we said, okay, fine, it's only plant waste, so how bad can it be? We'll put it in our fields. We put it in our rice fields. The next year there was an attack by some pests. The entire village lost their crop of rice. Only the Wendell Roderick's Kunbi unit had all this rice perfectly intact. And we were wondering what we did right. But actually, it was that dye that I spoke about, the Manjista dye, because of its antiseptic quality, it saved the rice from being eaten up by the pest. So then all the villagers were saying, can we please have some of your affluent? And we said, no, we're not going to give it to you now because you all didn't want it in the first place. Now we're keeping it all for ourselves. And we kept it there. So anyway, after this sari was launched, we began. First of all, Dada, who wove the sari in Arambol near the beach, he said, Baba, who's going to buy this sari? People will pay 700 rupees for a cotton sari, and that's about it. We are going to make no money because I was used to dealing with very small widths. Now I have to deal in this big width. I take so many weeks to weave one sari. You are never going to make any money out of it. The fact of the matter is that on the day of the show, Sonia Gandhi wanted to come and see the show. She sent a letter, which you'll see later. And everybody wanted to see the show because this sari was being revived. The Goa governor went and spread the word all over Delhi that this sari was going to be a revolution of its kind and a revival of its kind, and that they should go and have a look at it and buy the sari. So during the show, this is the girls who actually wore the sari. That's a lovely Nayanika Chatterjee, Candice Pinto. Sorry, I can't see that. Oh, Carol Gracious. Then we also made the Kunbi sari into fabric length so that we could convert them into kurtas, kaftans, etc. And that was the end of the show. We got Lisa Ray. She was 40 years old and just diagnosed with myeloma, multiple myeloma. Poor thing was losing her hair. I thought that's the last time we'll see her. We called her to celebrate her 40th birthday, but lo and behold, with stem cells, she survived. And she agreed to pose in the sari because she believed so much in this Kunbi sari. We made two versions for her, one in indigo and the other one in Manjista. This is Dipanita Sharma, shot in Coorg. Priyanka Gandhi wore the sari for many public occasions. And sari impresionados such as Jaya Jaitli from Dastakari Heart wore the sari, and Laila Tyabji from Dastakar. So we enjoyed this great privilege also. Jasleen Damija, one of our great icons of Indian textiles, and Nandita Das, who did the final epilogue for the fashion show, who wore the sari and who called all the models out. This is Ali Mathan, who started a program called Wear 100 Saris, one day after the next. She's from Bangalore. And this was the letter that Sonia Gandhi very kindly wrote to us and allowed us to sell the sari that was supposed to be worth 700, but we put it at 7,000. And there were people lining up. We had a one-year waiting list for the sari, mind you. And we opened a special room called the Eco Goa Room. And in this Eco Goa Room, we only stock eco-friendly fabric because my belief in cotton is so strong. Whether it is Uzruma's Malka fabric from Hyderabad, which I strongly recommend you all try to wear. It is the most bouncy, soft cotton on human skin, because the cotton is woven, woven into thread by tribals on the fields itself and has a unique spin, which is why I was called to open the world's largest garment fair in Nuremberg. And the eco-friendly room has the saris. And then my company told me to put this in because they said, because of your belief and because you're so modest, one of the citations when I won my Padma Shri, apart from the book Moda Goa, which was the research, 10-year research on the history of Goan costume, they also mentioned the Visionaire collection, which helped for the first time in the world blind people to read their clothing with Braille on it. I don't know why nobody thought of it before, but a blind man did ask me to do a collection, and after 9 months, we cracked the code of putting Braille on clothing, which is mandatory in every visually challenged school in the world. And because of all those three things, I was fortunate to be given the Padma Shri by the President of India. Thank you. you. Sit there.
Congratulations on this huge project that you took. It's quite amazing how you have turned a simple fisherman sari into something that's so fashionable. What was the actual purpose behind it?
Actually, the purpose behind it was to, I just want to encourage all the youngsters. You know, I have two weavers here in Kerala. I went and saw both of them. I saw one of them yesterday. One of them is Indu Mohan with Kara Weaves. I don't know whether she's here. I think she is here with a friend. Yeah, she's there. So, do you know Kerala, unlike the Northeast, who jumped into the fray and suddenly deluged us with their wonderful talent. I'm still waiting for the Kerala guys to do the same. Please do not abandon your cotton. You are a cotton state. You are not Tamil Nadu with their wonderful Kanjivarams. You are not Bangalore or Mysore with their beautiful silks. You are like Goa. You only have the cotton. So innovate. One of the things that I learned in Paris was my teacher told me, she said, Wendell, it's very easy to be the best designer in your school, on your street, in your college, in your city, in your state, in your country. But to really aspire to the top and to stand alongside the best in the world, you have to look at an international level, which is why our friends like Rahul Mishra and our dear friend here have won the Woolmark Award, because they were international from the beginning. And she said, the second thing you need to do is do not try to do what is in somebody else's DNA. Nobody can do a Kashmir as well as Rohit Bal. Nobody can do Calcutta as well as Sabyasachi. And if somebody does Goa better than me, I'll kill them. So, all you Kerala guys, you got to rank up your DNA, take from what's inside your soul, and give us new cottons, new weaves, that we will all be proud of you internationally.
So coming back to our main, our course agenda here about sustainable fashion, now, how do you take this to the masses? Because what we saw is very fashionable and I'm sure expensive as well. It's one of the problems in buying, say, organic cotton, simple as it may sound, is actually, it's very expensive.
It's not. Actually, I think you need to, like, you know, people enter this industry and they think that you're selling onions and potatoes. You're not going to make money in the first 6 years. I don't know, I didn't make money at all until my partner stepped into the business and gave me a business plan and gave my staff a business plan, because I'm a duffer at math. I don't know how to, I would be happily giving away the clothes free. I can't be creative and commercial. It's not possible. So my partner made a business plan and next year's projected sales and forced the shops to buy the collections. Of course, some shops refused outright. We left them, went to other shops who would buy. Now it's got to the point when everybody is giving on consignment and we have to rethink our strategy and say, we're not giving you free. We'll give you maybe pop-up shops, because I don't want to go back. I mean, by, you know, internationally they buy. So why should we just give them free and it hangs on racks and we have to keep track of thousands of clothes all over the country? So we do pop-up shops, and I don't think it's difficult. If you are a presence on social media, like I have learned to master it. I sell clothes on my Facebook, on Instagram, and on Twitter. And I know if I don't do my daily dose of social media, I know the sales fall, and it's a fact. I don't think you need a blogger. I mean, if you have a blogger friend, good for you. I think if you have journalist friends, even better. But I don't think people have the time to read. People just want to see a great photograph, see the price. So we, from this season onwards, we are not even going to take part in Fashion Week, because people just come and gawk at the clothes. So we are just going to make a kind of a moving lookbook, which we're going to put up on social media with the prices. And those who want to buy are going to buy, whether it's the public or the buyers in the boutique.
What's the price range that's
shipping this? In the Eco Goa room, we try not to put anything over 3,000 rupees. So I'm buying my Kerala cotton, I should not be telling you all this, at 185 rupees for 2.5 meters, and I sell it for 3,000.
Of course we are commercially viable. I think if you're not commercially viable, you might as well die and bury yourself.
Okay.
You have to be commercially viable, but you have to invest. You know, people say, oh my God, you're such a big name, and oh my God, people are buying, and we do get a lot of traffic. In fact, we have a traffic, we have a footfall where we have calculated 85% of footfall walks out with a bag. We make sure, you know, we've played games. I'm not saying that we are all, you know, virginal and pure. My partner put a bar in the shop. We are the only bar in the country in a boutique. So people who come from dry states, I don't know whether Kerala is a dry state. So the husbands sit in the bar and the wives do the shopping. They take out wads of money and say, make her buy so much. And we have to sell. I mean, if a designer doesn't sell, it's like the peacock dancing in the forest without an audience. You just can't be creative and not sell. You have to sell the clothes.
Which is exactly the problem with sustainable fashion, because the volume matters.
I think that's the designer's job. You know what I do? We make clothes, and my successor's doing, because I've given up my label to look after my museum. Shulen has been trained to create 40 looks for the ramp. She doesn't look 40 looks, she does 80 looks. And then we edit it, because you know we feel all these children, they're like our children. We love all of them and we have to show all of them. We don't show all of them. We call somebody from outside. We'll call a trusted fashion eye, whether it's a journalist or a fashion editor or sometimes even a client. And we say, we are going to show you the collection. Please tell us what to throw out. And they throw out, and no matter how much we loved it, and no matter how much technically I say, oh my God, you know, we took so long to drape this garment and make this pattern, they say, but it looks like nothing on ramp, so sorry. So they throw it out. And then we are left with 40 garments. Now those are ramp garments. We finish those garments 2 months ahead of Fashion Week, ideally. Maximum 6 weeks. From those 40, we know which ones are going to be bestsellers, and we know which ones can be translated into rack garments that will definitely sell. So in that balance 1.5 month, we only make copies of those garments that will definitely sell, which are the best sellers, as we call them, saying that we know that these 5 stores are definitely going to buy these garments. We make copies of them in 3 sizes. And the ones that we are going to sell, where it may have a dramatic collar, but no one's going to buy it. So we make that dramatic collar into a wearable collar, and we'll make another set of 40 garments and take orders on those. So you have to play the game. You have to make it look good on ramp, and you have to sell.
So Wendell, where is Wendell Rodrigues, the resort wear designer?
We, if you go on our website, wendellrodrigues.com, you'll find us on our own website.
Turning that into some, have you been inspired from the project here to actually turn that into something more sustainable?
Oh, we are already selling online. If you go to wendellrodrigues.com, we sell online. We sell quite a lot online, actually, because we are not in every city physically. But you'll also see a long list of retailers who buy our clothes.
How about the fabrics and everything that you use for that?
We are very cooperative buyers, dealers and suppliers of fabric. Like yesterday...
Is that sustainable?
Yes, it's very much sustainable. The thing about sustainable, I feel, I've been working in the industry now for almost 30 years. I think you cannot be like a European, I'm sorry to say this, a European company where one season, khatas in style, the next day you completely ignore that khata embroidery person and you jump to fulkari, and the next season you jump to something else. If you are working with your suppliers, please stay with them and innovate with them each season. Now yesterday I went to my one supplier and I found he made beautiful woven Kerala cotton, white on white, and I said, these look beautiful, I'm taking all 20 bales. Can you make for me 40 bales? And he said, yes, I'll give it to you in a week. So I think it depends on the rapport you make with your supplier to make him sustain, because he knows he's going to get so many lakhs of business from me every season.
Great. I'll open the audience for questions, if any.
I think they're all hungry, so. Yes. Can someone give her a mic, please? Or you can take mic. The people at the back can't hear.
Yeah, hi, my name is Tulika. I just wanted to know that all the fabric that you use, is that hand woven? Because you mentioned a price just now, which I think is very difficult to get in hand woven.
It depends on the fabric and it depends on the designer. There are designers that do very intricately woven fabric. We don't do that. We are a minimalist kind of philosophy. So we are telling people, like at the moment we've ordered a new batch of saris where the saris are either cream or black. Uh-huh. And the borders are in yellow silk, red silk or white.
But hand woven?
Hand woven, yes.
Oh, okay.
But we've learned how to, because we are working so closely with the weaver, mm-hmm. they tell us which part is difficult and which part they can take, they can do it faster for us. So even though we are working in the slums of Calcutta, mm-hmm. and we've forced them to move from cotton to linen, they find linen easier than cotton because they say it's stiffer, it's easier for them to work with. Of course, we have to wash the saris and the cloth after they weave it because they are weaving it in dismal conditions and we are fine with that. But it all depends how easy you make it for them. Some of them will say, give the thread to us starched because it's easier for us to, of course, it's easier for them to handle. So we say instead of it, us giving it to you starched, if we make the fiber thicker in a bigger count, or can we make it less dense? Would you be happier with that? Yes, they are happier with that. So it depends how closely you work, but if you're going to stand on top of their head and breathe down their neck and say, nahin, aisa hi chahiye, we want it exactly like this, and the border has to be, you know, sari borders come with from two fingers right up to one span, if you go through sari books.
Yeah.
So if you tell them, no, I want one span or one, there's a one, the biggest span is the elbow span, going from the edge of the elbow to the top of the fingers. And if you insist, they find it difficult to set up the loom, then you need 20 saris from them. And then designers are saying, but we can't sell 20 saris in one colorway.
Yeah.
So it's a marriage. We have to listen to them and they listen to us.
All right, thank you. Any more questions?
Hi, I'm Deepak from Hyderabad. So when you come to natural dyes, how strong they are? I mean, do they sustain on the fabric over the period of time or do they wear out?
It's gone off? No. It depends on your weaver.
Okay.
Where we do the dyeing, we have not only perfected the mordant, which anchors the dye to the fabric. They have even gone, because we have a very intelligent scientist gentleman who handles the mordant and the dyes. He has got them even to be UV light resistant. And apart from being machine washable. You know, UV light resistance means that even if I'm wearing a black shirt, I don't feel the heat. He has also got them to be antiperspirant because of that quality that they imbibe in the mordant. They are using very old recipes. Do you know from the time of Ostat, which we used to export in India, 3rd century BC to Egypt, they have revived some of those mordants because the Romans and the Greeks always wrote that the Indian dyes are so strong that they get brighter with each wash. So we are very fortunate on the Sawantwadi Goa Karnataka border that we have a dyer who is very passionate about his craft. Otherwise, in the old days, in the 70s and 80s, yes, we had natural dyes that would bleed and fade over time, but here they don't.
One last question. Do you have vendor relations? Do you do wholesale for your outfits?
Do we do wholesale for our outlets?
I mean, I have an outlet. If I want to sell your outfits, do you have those vendor relations?
We take orders, yeah.
Okay,
thank you. We take an order of a minimum of 40 to 60 pieces.
Okay. Thank you.
Welcome.
One last question. Works.
Yeah.
So how much does technology play in this whole process to make it viable for you?
Well, technology works on many levels. Firstly, it works on the what you call IT technology. Where we have to be on top of social media. Every time there's a new thing that happens, we can make, you know, models walk, we can make them turn around and go to the next garment. We can do so many things with that technology. And then we can also do technology based with the actual fabric itself.
Yeah, I meant technology with your weavers and your looms.
Yeah, we have, see, some things that we do like crepes and chiffons and georgettes and satins, they wrinkle easily when sat on. So we have to treat them with some amount of technology so that they wrinkle less, they crinkle less, and they also stay in place because they can be flimsy and move around the body quite often.
And how eco-friendly is that?
As Anil knows very well, we have what are called the vintage Wendell Rodericks wearers. They last for over 20 years.
Sorry?
They last for over 20 years. I don't believe in fast fashion. Because if you read this girl, I forget her name now, but she has a book called To Die For, Lucy Siegel. Lucy Siegel writes that for one t-shirt, just one t-shirt, your t-shirt, it takes 20 tons of water. And no matter which way you look at it, if you're looking at wool, you need grazing fields. If you're looking at mulberry leaves, which you need for silk, we are all using up the world's resources. So the faster we do without fast fashion, please concentrate on your style. Don't concentrate on fashion. Wear clothes that fit you. Wear colors that suit you. Don't think of throwing away things after one or two wearings and adding to the clothing garbage.
But which however, is so fast fashion too is...
Yeah, fast fashion is like you know, Primark.
Environmentally friendly.
It's completely environmentally unfriendly.
It is.
If you go to a place like Primark, you go to Primark on Bond Street, and you buy a T-shirt for £2, you know you're buying fast fashion. That T-shirt's not going
to
last.
Which comes to the question of how to actually sell a hand loom, hand woven, at the price of 3,000 to the consumer.
I think the consumer decides that. The consumer said, I'm buying this Wendell Rodericks and I'm buying some other brand.
So am I paying for Wendell Rodericks or am I paying for the hand woven?
No, you're paying for longevity and you're paying for something that is going with your style. You don't want to wear one style for one year.
Is your brand this?
It's not my brand. It's what my brand has come to stand for. It's not a conscious decision.
Yes, right. So, this Bundi Sari, does it stand for Wendell Rodericks collection or is it for the masses or for the niche? 3,000 is a very odd number to actually...
We cannot be masses. We cannot do masses because masses are too much to do. In fact, we've got orders from... I think it's called Apostrophe in New York. Apostrophe, New York.
Yes.
3,000 pieces. There's no way we could do 3,000 pieces. I mean, my tailors would just resign and go somewhere else.
So the point that sustainable fashion to be sustainable has to be controlled in numbers.
Yep.
And it's not very easy to actually make this kind of a project move to the masses at the moment.
No. Designer wear cannot be masses unless you're doing a one-week pop-up shop at H&M or one of those brands where Kate Moss does something for Zara or whatever it is. Maybe that's possible, but they know they have a limited number of pieces to sell and they sell out, but you can't sustain that on a regular basis.
Right. Oh, great, thank you.
Thank you everyone for your time. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. And our request, Mr. Rahul Raj, Director Operations, Marriott Kochi, to give a token of appreciation to Mr. Wendell Rodericks. Welcome, sir. Thank you so much, Mr. Wendell Rodericks, for giving us valuable insights on hand-woven curtain with natural dyes. Ladies and gentlemen, a huge round of applause for this wonderful session. Thank you so much.